Grace and peace to you through our Lord Jesus Christ. We are glad to be back with you after our quarantine with our kids, though we wish we could see more of you who are worshiping with us on YouTube. We are grateful to see those of you who are here in the sanctuary. We are working on plans for an outdoor communion service in August, so stay glued to those weekly pastoral letters for information about that. Also coming up in August is a popsicle fellowship time. But this week, our Seeker Work Camp heads out not to Lynchburg, Virginia, as originally planned, but to Pottstown and surrounding areas. We will be taking the message of shalom, of wholeness, of peace and healing and reconciliation to our own community and doing work at the Ricketts Center, at some locations in Hobart's Run, at the Natural Lands Trust and the Schuylkill River Heritage Association. And we look forward to this different version of summer work camp. You can invest in this, and we hope that you will, by purchasing stock for $10 a share that will help us cover the materials for the construction projects. And coming up in July is our middle school version of this, Mission Mornings. So watch for information from Jalee, middle schoolers, about your own opportunities to work in our community. The church library will open this week on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and we are thankful to Laura Hazeltine, who will be staffing that. We need to add to the Wishing You Well list. A request has come for prayers for Karen and Keith Plumador's niece, Heather. So we will be including her in our prayers, along with those in the Wishing You Well list in the pastoral letter. And now, let us prepare to worship. Please join me as we pray together the prayer of preparation. Let us pray. God of grace, you have given us minds to know you, hearts to love you, and voices to sing your praise. Fill us with your Spirit that we may celebrate your glory and worship you in spirit and in truth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Whether we are here in the sanctuary or in our homes, let us stand in body or in spirit to remind ourselves that we are in presence of God, that indeed this is a day the Lord has made, and it is time to rejoice and be glad in it. Sing to the Lord a new song.
Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord, praise God's name.
Proclaim God's salvation day after day.
And our opening hymn is Morning Has Broken.
Friends, if we claim to be without sin, we do not see ourselves clearly. No one escapes sin's infection. It is a global pandemic. But there is a cure for this disease of the heart and soul and mind. It is the mercy of God and the curative power of divine grace. The pill we must take is sometimes bitter. We begin with confession. Let us do so together and examine our hearts and minds in silence and as God's people. Please join me as I confess with the prayer in the bulletin. Holy and merciful God, in your presence, we confess our sinfulness, our shortcomings, and our offenses against you. You alone know how often we have sinned in wandering from your ways, in wasting your gifts, in forgetting your love. Have mercy on us, O Lord. Forgive our sins and help us to live in your light and walk in your ways for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Friends, no infection is so deep, no soul so damaged that it is beyond the reach of God's grace. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. There is more grace in God than sin in us. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Jesus says, "Behold, I am making all things new.
Hello, boys and girls. It has been a while since I've been able to talk to you this way, but it's been an even longer while since I've gotten a chance to see you, and I miss you. But we'll keep doing it this way for now. But first, I've got a hard question to ask you. And one, it's okay with me if you don't answer it out loud in front of your parents, but you can answer it inside. Have you ever done something you know you weren't supposed to? Maybe, you know, you weren't supposed to use your video game, but you snuck and played it when you weren't supposed to. Or maybe you said something mean to a brother or sister or a friend, something you knew you shouldn't have said. Or maybe your mother or father asked you if you had done something and you said you had and you hadn't. Ever been a time when you hadn't told the truth? Or something broken? You tried to clean it up so no one would see. Yep, I've done that too. And you know what I remember is that when you do it, it is this bad feeling inside. The longer you don't say anything about it, it's like almost, sometimes you can almost get like a stomach ache. But what I also know, and what I also remember when I was your age, how good it felt when I finally told someone and admitted it. Sometimes I had to have a timeout. I mean, sometimes I did get something taken away for a while. But at the end, my mom or my dad would hug me and say, "Okay, we just won't try to do that again, right?" And I knew I was loved. We all do things that we're not supposed to do. But it's good when we can say, "I was wrong. I did it. I'm sorry." And it's even better when someone tells us, "That's okay. I love you." Each week when we say the Lord's Prayer, and I hope that you're starting to learn the Lord's Prayer, that you can say it with us. Maybe you can practice at home. We have this phrase where we say, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." And maybe you wonder what that means. But what it basically is saying, "God, I'm sorry. I was wrong. Forgive me when I do those things." And then the second part of the prayer reminds us that when someone does something to hurt us and they say, "I'm sorry," that we need to tell them, "That's all right." Because you know what? There is nothing better than being able to go out with that friend that you had an argument with and play again. Or sitting next to your brother, your sister, one of your parents who you did something wrong with, and just being able to smile again. That's the way it is with God. God forgives when we do things wrong, and God wants to help us forgive others when they do things wrong. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. We have to do that a lot, so much that we say it every week here in church. But it's a good thing. I'll see you later.
Thank you. We continue this morning with an off-and-on series this summer on Paul's letter to the Corinthians. I'll begin at the end of chapter 1 of 2 Corinthians and then read the first 11 verses in chapter 2. But I call on God as witness against me. It was to spare you that I did not come again to Corinth. I do not mean to imply that we lord it over your faith. Rather, we're workers with you for your joy, because you stand firm in the faith. So I made up my mind not to make to you another painful visit. For if I cause you pain, who is there to make me glad but the one whom I have pained? And I wrote as I did, so that when I came, I might not suffer pain from those who should make me rejoice. For I am confident about all of you that my joy would be the joy of all of you. For I wrote you out of much distress and anguish of heart and with many tears, not to cause you pain, but to let you know the abundant love that I have for you. But if anyone has caused pain, he has caused it not to me, but to some extent, not to exaggerate it, to all of you. This punishment by the majority is enough for such a person. So now instead you should forgive and console him so that he may not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. So I urge you to reaffirm your love for him. I wrote for this reason to test you and to know whether you were obedient in everything. Anyone whom you forgive, I also forgive. What I have forgiven, if I have forgiven anything, has been for your sake in the presence of Christ. And we do this so that we may not be outwitted by Satan, for we are not ignorant of his designs. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Lord, you have what our souls need. And we pray by your Spirit that we might hear what we need to hear, that your holy word might be heard through these human words. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. My dad was able to play golf once or twice a week, up till his death at age 90. In fact, he played the week before he died. He and his good friend Roger coordinated a group of people, I think they were all 80 and older, and they would play every Tuesday or Thursday as Atlanta weather permitted. After he died, the golf club kindly packed up his clubs and everything that was in his locker and dropped them off at my mom's place, and I had a chance to go through it. And when I did, I found the most extraordinary memo typed. It sounded much like many of the ones that I'm sure he had prepared in his lifelong time working for General Electric in management. It was a series of talking points with some unnamed member of the group. Apparently, this person was known to cheat and to curse a lot, so much that no one really enjoyed playing with him. So what Dad was going to tell this man was that he and Roger would play with him, but only the two of them, and this man would be on probation. And then they would see whether he could change his ways. You can imagine my curiosity after reading this memo. I mean, who was this man, and what did he actually do? Dad had kept that out of the notes. And did they have this talk with him? Was he still on probation when my dad died? And think about it, how many 80-plus-year-olds get kicked out of a group because of bad behavior? In much the same way, we have a lot of unanswered questions when it comes to this passage that I just read from 2 Corinthians. Paul refers here to a painful visit and also to a painful letter that he wrote to the Corinthians, one he wrote out of much distress and anguish of hearts and with many tears. Then he talks about sounds like a man who was punished and ostracized.
but who now, Paul thinks, should be forgiven and welcomed back. What caused all this pain? Who was this man, and what did he and others with him actually do or say? Paul and the Corinthians obviously know. He doesn't have to say anything more. But 2,000 years later, we don't really know for sure. The best scholarly guess is that this man and others came behind Paul and started to preach a different message, attacked Paul personally, and in so doing, were undermining what he had built up in the church in Corinth. But even though we don't know everything we would like to know about this, what Paul is talking about here, it does not mean that we can't get something out of this passage. Indeed, Paul has some vitally important lessons here for our life together as family, as friends, and as a community of faith. What Paul wants the Corinthians to know, what he wants us to know, is that love forgives. So now, he writes, you should forgive and console him so that he might not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. Forgiveness, however, is where Paul ends. It's not where he begins this passage. Love forgives, but for Paul, love also confronts and corrects. Paul regrets that he had to make that painful visit and write that painful letter because they were difficult to do. But that doesn't mean that he regrets actually doing either one of them. He sent that letter because he felt he had to. For I wrote you out of much distress and anguish of hearts, not to cause you pain, but to let you know the abundant love that I have for you. He sent the letter because he was worried about the harm that this man and any group around him were doing to the life of the church in Corinth. So it is for us. Forgiveness is vital for families and friendships and communities of faith because we are all imperfect. We all do at some time or another hurt others, even those we love. But there are also times that precede forgiveness when we too may need to gently confront someone or speak up and say, this hurt me, or this is wrong, or something must change. These can be difficult and painful conversations, but also necessary ones, as they were for Paul and the Corinthian church. The key to follow Paul's example is that the conversations must be done out of love and with love. But that's easier said than done, isn't it? How do we talk through what is bothering us or what is dividing us with love? Well, here are some suggestions to consider. First, we pray about it. It seems obvious, but sometimes, many times perhaps, it's a step we overlook. We pray to understand what we are feeling inside and whether we need to say something to someone about that. We pray for the courage to say what needs to be said. Sometimes, as with Paul, we need to confront and speak up, not just for our own sake, but for the sake of others. We pray for the wisdom to know when and how to speak. Sometimes, like Paul, we want to press forward with it, as he did when he visited Corinth and sent that painful letter. But sometimes we may need to step back to give it some space, as he does when he postponed his second visit. We also want to pray for those who have wronged us or who stand in the way of needed change, that they may have an open spirit and listen. But at the same time, we want to pray for ourselves, that we too may have an open spirit and be willing to listen. Second, as the authors of a gem of a book called Difficult Conversations put it, we need to treat each conversation as a possible learning experience. They write, our initial purpose for having a difficult conversation after someone has hurt us or there is some kind of conflict is often to prove a point, to give them a piece of our mind, or get them to do or be what we want. In other words, to deliver a message. If you're like me, you may really practice and polish that message in your mind. I've been known to do it the whole time cutting the grass. And then be all ready and expect to deliver it like a lawyer, where it's just so eloquent and so passionate that the jury can't help but immediately stand up and say guilty. But that assumes that we know all the truth all the time. Perhaps there are important details we're not aware of. Perhaps we don't have the whole picture. Every conflict involves conflicting perceptions and feelings that may have to be sorted through and understood. And we're very much aware of how other people's words and actions have impacted us. But often, we're not nearly as aware of how our words and actions have impacted others. In other words, it's not enough to deliver a message, no matter how eloquent it may be. It's not enough to hit send on that email or to post our rant on our social media site. No, if we're going to live as Christians, we have to be willing to listen and to seek to understand just as much as we want to be able to speak and be understood. Nearly always, that means a face-to-face conversation with someone where we have to set aside our defensiveness, as hard as that may be. Because without a conversation, there's no opportunity to listen. In churches and communities of faith, that's why anonymous letters are not helpful in congregational life. Because without a name, there's no opportunity for conversation, for listening and understanding. A father found that his 11-year-old son was taking money from him, money that he would have on his dresser, and happened pretty consistently. But even worse in the father's eyes is that when he confronted his son lied and denied it. At first, the father was ready to give the son a piece of his mind and let him know with no uncertainty that there's no stealing or lying in this family. But the last minute, he stepped back and decided to use a more even-handed voice to tell his son that he, the father, knew what his son had done, that he'd taken money and was not being honest about it. And then he asked, gently though, and not with the voice of a prosecutor doing a cross-examination, "Why did you do it, son?" As it turned out, the son was being bullied at school. It was not long after 9/11, the family was Muslim, and he was being bullied, and the boy was afraid to tell parents or report it because he feared it could get worse, and that's why he lied. Can you imagine how grateful the father was that he didn't go charging into his son's room, yelling and accusing him out of anger? Love confronts, but gently, and is always willing to listen and to learn and to assume or not to assume that we know everything. Another practical suggestion is to focus on impact rather than intent. Consider the story of Lori and Leo, thankfully not members of this congregation. They were at a party with friends, and Lori reached for a second scoop of ice cream. Leo gently said to her, "Lori, why don't you lay off the ice cream?" You can imagine how well that went over. In fact, it was an argument that lasted on and on for a long time. Finally, with a counselor, Lori said, "You acted like my father or something. You have this need to control me or to put me down." Leo sputtered, "I wasn't trying to hurt you. You said you were on a diet, and I thought that was the most helpful thing for me to do." The problem is that when you focus only on intentions, you can get stuck. Lori was naming what she assumed were his intentions or motivations. But no one really can read someone else's mind. And then Leo focused on intentions, thinking that if his were good, he could convince his wife that there was no real harm. Somehow he didn't really have a defense. They were stuck until, with a counselor's help, they could shift the conversation from intentions to impact. In other words, what mattered was that Leo said that in front of others. And what mattered was how it made Lori feel, regardless of what his intentions were. When the counselor pointed that out and helped them to guide the conversation to a better place, Leo could finally say, "I'm sorry. I don't like hurting you. Let's think about what I should do or say, if anything, the next time." "Good idea," Lori agreed. In politics, we often see people use labels and insults to short-circuit the discussion. "You're not a true patriot," or "You're a bigot." Labels and assumptions about intentions and motivations may be helpful in causing people to take sides. "You're on my side," or "You're not on their side." But they're never actually helpful to finding solutions for problems, because they cut off the discussion and they distract us away from the underlying problems we were trying to address anyway. The same is true for discussions and disagreements in the life of a congregation. Labels and assumptions about intentions and motivations, about faith of the other, are never helpful. When we grapple with difficult issues, whether it involves interpretations of the scriptures or more mundane church decisions, we don't have to always agree. But we can agree to give each other the benefit of the doubt, to assume that those who disagree with us are trying just as hard as we are to be faithful. When we do that, then we might find that we really do need each other to define the truth and discern God's will. Because all of us have some wisdom to offer, and all of us have some blind spots. Sometimes love means having the difficult conversation, addressing that which, if unchecked, will harm others or harm the community. That's what Paul is doing here with the Corinthian church. That's why he made that painful visit and wrote that painful letter. But since love is his motivation, banishment and division are not a permanent solution. Love always moves towards forgiveness, towards consolation and reaffirmation, Paul reminds us. And he gives a personal example. He's ready to let go of his grievances against this individual, as serious as they might be, for the sake of the healing of the Corinthian church family. Bishop Desmond Tutu fought the brutality of apartheid for most of his life in South Africa. He was tried in kangaroo courts. He spent time in jail unjustly. After the fall of apartheid, he served as the moderator of the country's Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which sought to bring to light the terrible history of atrocities and false arrests and beatings and killings that happened under apartheid by the government or agents of the government. And yet, even as this commission brought to light those atrocities, Bishop Tutu was concerned that it not lead to a continuing cycle of revenge and reprisal. He told the commission that what had to be their ultimate goal was this: 6 hard words. "There is no future without forgiveness." What he said about his South African society applies to our relationships as well. Without forgiveness, there is no hope for healing. How many lives have we watched eaten away by the corrosive acids of unforgiven hurts? How many times have we seen families and communities torn apart by unresolved conflict and lingering bitterness? That does not mean that we ignore or excuse what someone has done to us. No, to forgive is instead to have this conversation with ourselves, which basically says, I was hurt, I am angry, and I have reason to be. But I am willing to set that aside for the sake of our relationship, for the sake of myself, that I'm willing to let this down and to live with an uneven score. Forgiveness also does not mean that we have to forget the past. In fact, it's not possible to forget the past. But we can move beyond the past so that the past does not define our relationship with that person. We forgive because it is in our own self-interest to forgive. Until we forgive, the one who has hurt us has continuing power over us. They're still in our minds and in our clenched hearts. But we don't just forgive for our own health. We also forgive because that is what love does. And that is what God has done for us. God's love forgives. We may not feel that we have it in us to forgive someone, but we don't have to have it in us. As someone has said, God has opened many a clenched fist. With God, what seems impossible can actually become possible. Ellen had a brother named Jerry. He was an alcoholic, and she found him harder to stand at each family gathering. Years ago, he had especially infuriated her after their mother died because he took the piano, his mother's piano. She was the only one who played, and she always assumed it would come to him. As time went on, things got so bad, she just cut off relations with him and said she would never speak to him again. Then one midnight he called, his voice panic-stricken. The house was on fire. He had passed out drunk with a cigarette. The cigarette had ignited in the carpet, and now there was a fire in his house. She raced over, and she got there just as the fireman brought out the smoldering piano. Jerry turned to her, his eyes filled with tears. "Isn't it awful?" he choked. "Like losing Mom all over again. I sometimes think the only time I was ever happy when I was growing up was when I sat and listened to the music she made." Ellen had never realized how unhappy her brother's childhood had been. Nor did she have any idea what the piano really meant, what it symbolized. She had a whole new perspective on his obnoxious behavior. And with surprise, she heard her own voice saying as she turned to him, "I've missed you. I've missed you." That is what God says in and through Jesus Christ to anyone who has turned away or wandered away and turns back to God. And that is hope. That's what God hopes we will discover in all of our relationships with others. Sometimes love speaks up to have the difficult conversation. But always, love works toward forgiveness and understanding and healing. Amen. As forgiven people, let us stand together and affirm our faith with the words you'll see from a brief statement of faith. In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and releasing the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with sinners, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent
and believe the gospel. Amen.
Take a seat.
At this time, we would like to commission those who participate in the work camp ministry in the coming week. Tim and Gwen and Jalee answer on behalf, on behalf of all those who will participate. And we hope that you, where you are, will also stand and answer the questions. Ashley Livesey, Abby Campbell, Corinne Hoffman, Joy Hoffman, Paige Barkus, Emily Weber, Zoe Enderline, Jack Casella, Gabe Roseo, Luke McDonald, Ben Drago, Zach Lipsky, Becca Lipsky, Alina Orzakowski, Clara Orzakowski, Sam Mulholland, Natalia Bradley, Delaney Bradley, Peyton Vogt, Gwen Allen, Tim Allen, Melinda Casella, Don Casella, Kim Wheelis, Heather Temple, Megan Ziegler, John Livesey, John McDonald, Jalee Ferrari, and Carter and myself. Friends, Jesus tells us, I have come to lift up those who are weighed down, to bring good news to the poor, to care for the hungry, to show mercy. And God charges us as well to be good stewards of the earth. Come, follow me, says Jesus. And Paul says, bear one another's burdens. You have heard Jesus' summons to go and to join his work in the world, to be his hands, his feet, his voice, his touch, to extend his ministry. We ask you to dedicate yourself and your work to show the risen Christ in the world, to the glory of God and to the service of his people. And so we invite you to commit your work and your week to this ministry. We ask you, are you willing to be commissioned as outreach ministers, ambassadors of Christ, to work in our community? If so, will you say, I am? Do you welcome this responsibility because you are determined to follow the Lord Jesus, to love neighbors, and to work for the reconciling of the world? Do you? Will you serve the people and the places with energy, diligence, cheerfulness, with love and respect, relying on God's mercy and rejoicing in God's promises? And will you live faithful to our covenant so that we together might grow deeper in Christ and reach farther in love? Will you? And do we, the members of this congregation, accept these sisters and brothers as ambassadors called by God and appointed to this work? Will we support them as they represent us in our community? Will you answer, we do.
Let us pray.
Oh Lord, we give you thanks for those who are giving of this time in this way, for those who have prepared the way in finding these projects and determining what needs to be done. And we pray for a good week, that you would give the strength and compassion and all the things that are needed to help these people keep these promises and serve you in this way. And although this is not the place we originally were supposed to go, and these are certainly not the circumstances that we originally would have chosen to be part of, we know you will be here among us, and we pray that our eyes and our ears and our hearts might be alert to the gifts that you have to offer to us this week. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us continue our prayers as we join in the prayers of the people. The Lord be with you. Jesus, people came to you when they were in trouble or pain. Friends carried them. Strangers told you about them. Some invited you into their homes or met you walking on the road. You listened to them and prayed with them. You brought hope and healing into their lives. So today we bring into our minds and hold in God's presence those whom your Spirit has bidden us to pray for. Christ, you welcomed children and blessed them. You gave their parents courage and hope. So we name before you, aloud or in silence, all children and parents strained in the shadows of this season, and all who make decisions about their care and their education. Lord, hear our prayer. Jesus, through your words and touch, those who were distressed found peace, and those who were tormented found rest. So we name before you, aloud or in silence, those who fight against depression, anxiety, hopelessness, whose faith is waning in these days. Lord, hear our prayer. Jesus, you prayed for those who were sick and you restored them to health. So we name before you now those whom we know to be sick, Bob and Anna, Don, Dan, Glenn, Heather, Shiloh, Kathy. Lord, hear our prayer. Jesus, you wept for the city you loved. In your words and actions, the oppressed found justice and the angry found release. So we name before you now the community in which we live, in this nation which we love. Set us right and help us to seek, to find, and do the right. Lord, hear our prayer. Jesus, you cried when a friend died and you shared the grief of those who mourn. So we name before you all who face losses, old or new, especially those who face them isolated and alone, whom we name before you now, aloud or in silence. Lord, hear our prayer. And Jesus, you knew the joy of God's presence day by day, minute by minute. So we name before you all who will be part of the work camp this week. May they know the joy of your presence and know themselves to be in your realm. Lord, hear our prayer. We thank you, O Lord, for all engaged in the ministries of healing and reconciliation, for those who work in hospitals and hospices, for doctors and nurses, carers and counselors, for peacemakers and peacekeepers. God, our Maker, Jesus, our Healer, Holy Spirit of love and life, hear our prayers. To those who seek you, to all who need you, to the world you cherish, bring healing, bring wholeness, bring peace. We pray as you taught us to pray, as so many have prayed before us and so many will pray after us, as confident children. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory Amen. As God's people, let us go out from this place singing. Let us stand and sing, Though I May Speak.
Friends, know that you are loved, and go forth to love. May the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord lift the lightest countenance upon you and give you peace, now and in the days to come. Let the people say, Amen.